Yeah, so Stefan, das bist du. Ich arbeite mit einem Freelance-Vertreter. Thank you. Heute wollen wir über Better of the Sea, aber sind wir jetzt mit einem Namen von dem Portugiesisch, dass wir nur kontinuierlich in Englisch.
Sounds cool.
Sounds good.
Nice.
So the talk will be just like really the basic, like so taking a look to the APIs and some working examples, mainly like the audio and video communication. So let's start. So here's the agenda. First I will give a short overview what the RTC is for those who don't know it, but I think at least everybody I think which I was talking to already knows it. Then we'll dive into underlying APIs. Then we will have a look at the signaling server. And as it is a PHP meetup, I was developing it in PHP, but I actually, for like really using it in production, I would suggest to use some kind of JS or which proved that it's nature for doing this stuff.
Yeah. And it is the right book for the right job.
Yeah. And then we'll have a look at how we'll be able to traverse NOTs and firewalls in order to connect the clients peer to peer. And in the end, I hope we'll have a working demo. So back in the days, it was really cumbersome to have a real-time communication in your website or on the web as a whole. But thanks to the developers at Mozilla and Google pushing the bar, we now have a plugin-free real-time communication, which is low cost because you connect peer-to-peer, so you don't have a lot of bandwidth, at least not yours. And it's high quality, the audio and video, and I really can say it's already 10 times better than Skype. I tested it on the same connection with my mother first in WebRTC and now on Skype, and WebRTC images like almost HD. And Skype was like just lots of pixels. And it even offers you a way to communicate parallel data between two clients directly. But this one I'm not going to work in that. So in which browsers does it already work? It's really well working on Chrome and Firefox and Opera as well. Then it should work on Chrome for Android, but I didn't test it. And there seems to be some native Objective-C and Java bindings around for those who are developing apps for Android or for iPhone. So this means we're already on like 1 billion plus clients who are able to use WebRTC. Sadly, there is one falling away right now. They're doing their own stuff now and suggesting other APIs.
Of course they are.
But I think like the Google thing is really, or the B3C thing is really good because it takes away a lot of difficult stuff that Microsoft wants to have. You do the full control over everything, which I don't know if it's really needed or not. So let's see what the APIs are about. We have three main APIs in JavaScript which you can use. One is the user media, which you use for getting audio, video, and screen capture. Then you have the RTC peer connection, which is used to connect the two clients peer to peer. And you have the RTC data channel, which is actually used to transfer data as you like it. So this third kind of covered in this talk. So in order to have it a bit more easy, I use adapter.js in the examples I used in this talk, which is abstracting the Chrome and Firefox differences and removing the vendor prefixes. So unfortunately it won't work on Opera because it doesn't cover Opera right now. So the get user media is actually pretty simple. You just set here in the constraints which what you would like to access from the user. Like in this example, the audio and video, and then you just pass it to the get user media method, where you have a success callback and the error callback. The success callback is fired if the user allows you to access his devices, and the error callback if he is not allowing you to access it. So how does the success callback look like? We got here an object which is called the media stream object, which is containing the different streams. You have like the audio and the video. And first we just add it to a local DOM element, which is a video element for just playing it back. But for later on I also assign it to a global variable, so we can use it later on as well. And error callback I actually didn't cover right now. So there's already a really nice working example outside, which is called the ASCII camera. Maybe you already saw it, some of you, but for those who don't know it, I'm going to show you. Yes, I will show my eyes. Actually, with the fish, that's it.
The camera is very good. Yeah, camera is very good.
So, then we have the next API, which is the RPC peer connection. So this one is actually doing lots of stuff for us.
Can I say?
Yeah, I think it would be really difficult for like the normal web developer to just figure out how to do it. So it first connects the two peers together, then it looks to traverse around the nets and firewalls, if possible. And it does some stuff like noise reduction or video jitter reduction. And compression, decompression, of course. And also bandwidth management. So if you have a small bandwidth, it doesn't use it, lowers the quality of the video and all that stuff. And last but not least, the RSA protection, which means it's encrypting the whole media stream which passes around peer to peer.
But they also don't have any encryption.
At least they try.
You know how it works?
Not really. I just.
Because if it's peer to peer and there's nothing in common and I don't know you and I want to open a channel, protect the channel with you, I'm not sure how they manage to do it.
Yeah, you actually not. We will see that later. You actually have, like, for getting each other, you pass it in.
So it's not peer to peer actually. There's something in the middle, or
we'll see that
later. Okay.
So the architecture of the whole thing is like, if Alice wants to call, she's sending an offer to Bob. He answers with another offer, and then they can establish the connection. That's like the simple version of it. The offer just contains like the description, what kind of media you're offering, what codecs are you using, and stuff like this. And this looks like this in JavaScript. It's you're actually creating the peer connection here, then you're adding local stream you saved before to the peer connection, and then you have to do somehow the decision which one is the caller and which one is the callee. So if it's the caller, it's sending the offer with a callback here. as soon as you get the description back from the browser, you have it to add it to the peer collection and send it to the old peer. It's going to be just, for now we assume that it's just working somehow, but we'll see later on how this is really working. Then Bob receives the buffer and he assigns it as a remote instruction to his peer collection. And later on, as he sees, he's got an offer, he's answering with creating an answer, which is following the same callback like the one before, like sending just back to Alice. So then the connection is established and it's applied. Like when you're calling this method, this is calling a callback on the other side somehow. So you're getting here to got the remote stream callback where you attach the stream just to another video element or to whatever it is that you like to do. So an example for this would be this one. Where I say star at it is asking me for the for my thing. So now I have to load the video somehow and I am starting the call. Hopefully it should work, but it's not actually working. It should come here, but it can be sometimes there are some delays when it starts working. I tested it. It works.
It's working.
Yeah, but it's quite slow. It's quite slow.
Yeah, you are streaming the video, so probably.
Maybe that's the same. So, we're already coming to the signaling server, which is actually pretty easy in this case. So, by servers, like you already asked the questions. One reason is you need a server to transfer the offer and the answer. And there's another thing which comes later, ISP candidates, which are building up the connection. And then you need some kinds of servers to bypass the NATs and the firewalls. So first we're going to see the signaling server. How this one is implemented. So as I said, you send the offer to the signaling server and just relies it over to Bob. And you can implement that one however you like. It could be Ajax or or something else.
So the session, let's say it's just starting the session between two peers, maybe in Ajax, like a normal HTTP, or in WebSock.
Yeah, WebSock, it's whatever. You just have to make sure you're passing it to the other client, however you do that. Yeah. Maybe you can even email it and inject it to the code.
Like
So, how is the signaling service built on Ratchet, which itself is built on React PHP, which likes to be the Node.js in the PHP, actually. But as even the developer of this in May, he was answering the question that we don't use it in production, so he doesn't think it's really ready or major for production. So, those who already did some Node.js, I think this is quite common for working with WebSockets. You have the message which is called when the client connects. There we going to find a node partner, and if there is already a node partner connected, you can connect the other one to the new one will be the caller, and if not, it's just in the waiting line for another one to connect. And then just sending back this handshake message. So actually pretty simple, I think. And then we have the one message. This is called when the client sends, for example, the offer or the answer. This one is called, so we have to find the paired part here and just relay the message to him. And as we heard, we should maybe synthesize the user input here. I don't know what he can do with it, but maybe it would be a good idea. So for stopping the server, we have this small child script, which is here we create a WebSocket server, and then we pass the signaling server, the SOC 4, and we just let it run forever on port 88. So now we're coming to the point of natural rehearsal. Until now, the whole secret connecting media streams is like the real world, but as you all know, the dream world, but the real world looks more like this, that we have a net here and a net here, which is blocking the traffic, so we need to find a way to pass around the firewalls. The first one is the cheap one. This is a stun server, which basically Alice calls the stun server, which you can reach by HTTP, and the stun server do some tests like can I connect on the same port that the question was coming from, can I connect to a different port or not, and then it decides if it's possible to build up a peer-to-peer connection or not. And if it's possible, it sends back the IP address and the port which to connect to. And Bob on the other side is the same, and afterwards they are exchanging the signals that get back to like the candidates back for the signal server. And then the more expensive way is the turn server, which comes if it's done, if the peer-to-peer is not working, then it will try, the peer connection will try to use the turn server, which is a relaying server. So actually this one isn't peer-to-peer anymore, so the media stream will flow to the turn server to another one and back to Bob. But I think it's Web RPC stats.org or something, they published a compilation using it like with a fallback in Flash. They published that it's like I think 85% or something which are able to use peer-to-peer, and the rest they have to need a fallback or turn server. So, yeah, and the whole thing is, which is the ICE, Interactive Connectivity Establishment, is actually handling the whole stuff with the stun and turn server. So, when you create the peer connection, you just say, I've got the following service, like the stun server, or if you have a turn server as well, or as many you have, you can pass in there. And it will first try the stun method, like the peer-to-peer method, and then if one works, it will elevate to a turn server. And then you have here another callback you have to call, which as soon as it found the candidate, you're just passing back to the peer-to-peer. Like, and for that, of course, we're going to use the signaling server as well. So, when the candidate comes in to the other method here, he's just have to add it to his open peer connection, and then the magic will happen by itself. So, it's demo time, so can someone please just go here to the with the phone?
No?
I don't know if it's working.
That's fine.
You are waiting for anyone to...
Yeah. But I think they're already...
You're on the way.
Yeah, so,
Why do multiple people call it? You think more than one people calls you?
Well, it's...
Explodes.
I've had it in the server side. Like, the server looks like the first people connects, and then the second one, it matches those two together, so if he's trying now, he's trying those two bunch together, like...
Start I see with what we see there.
Yeah, maybe it's really the network here. Yeah, but actually this would be finished, but I think as we was talking about here, one really important thing that I found, you have the, I told you that there's an encryption for the peer-to-peer media stream, but the signaling way you're doing, you should protect yourself by encryption to make it real secure, because I don't know what happens if I can see a nice candidate or something.
No, because I will try to shut down the streaming to see if you can test your demo. So say goodbye to the guys at home. Bye bye, guys at home.
Yeah, so I'd like to thank you, and I think tomorrow in the evening you can find the slides and all the JavaScript that will be based off my GitHub account, which you can find on PHP Alexis. Don't send it to
right now.
You should have more bandwidth.
We can let it run.
try Alpha to see what that spot works.
Good.
Now you have to copy that URL and send it to another message. Or maybe someone can copy the numbers.
Or maybe it was the server, but it's not possible. Yeah, but maybe you don't
see the
level. Room is fucked. And try to open that link yourself in another
tab.
Can you try this one? We have to be fast. Waiting for someone. It's correct.
It's 7.3.0.
So I guess it's not ready for production.
No, no, it is. It was always running. I tried it. I have already hours of calls with friends.
Questions? No questions about the FTC? No one? Okay.
Yes,
wait, one question.
Do you know about mobile support for WebRTC? When it's coming and
what about?
Mobile support.
Mobile.
If it works on iPhone, then.
Yeah, for iPhone, you have the Objective-C findings where you can develop apps. And I think Ericsson once developed an app, which is a browser app, which you can use. But Apple itself, they're just don't talking any stuff about it. Even Safari, they didn't have it yet. So from that side, you analyze that box as well.
If you have more than two peers, or multi-peer share like Google and Health, what is your best approach?
Yeah, there's actually different approaches. Like I read it somewhere that the Polkadot Pro is allowing max 10 connections because else the bandwidth would go up. And there's, if you go to my GitHub account, I'm following a project which is called LeetCode, and they're doing a MCU, remote computing unit, which is a server which takes in the streams and then mix them together or send it out to the other peers. So you should be able to have something like Hangout or a teacher talking to many actually not. They just switched to the VP8 codec, the video codec which is used in. And so the rumors are there that they wanting to switch to. But I think they'll do it because it's not far away. Maybe they're already trying to use it. Yeah.
Thank you.